Hi guys, welcome back, and today we're going to talk about what it's like to have a career as an astronomer. During today's presentation, I'm going to go over a general overview of astronomy, but if you ever want to learn more, I recommend you check out this article by the International Astronomical Union. Before we get into what an astronomer actually is, I want to ask you something. If you ever go out and look at the night sky, what do you think about? What do you see? Personally, I've always loved looking at the night sky. I always try to find the Big Dipper, which is literally the only constellation I know, but I also love to just sit there and appreciate the beauty of the stars. And as simple as that sounds, that's kind of the essence of astronomy. Astronomers are people that admire the beauty of the stars, but also go beyond that because they want to understand what they are, how they work, and how they relate to the history of our universe. An astronomer is a scientist who tries to understand and interpret the universe beyond our planet. Astronomers study the origin and makeup of the universe, including its planets, stars, galaxies, black holes, and many more. There are really two main types of astronomers: observational and theoretical. Observational astronomers are the ones who directly observe objects in space and analyze the data that comes from them. On the other hand, theoretical astronomers create models of things that can't really be directly observed. As you can imagine, the history of our galaxy is incredibly long and very complex. It takes millions to billions of years for a system of stars or a galaxy to complete its life cycle, so it's impossible to directly observe how they form, evolve, and die. Astronomers must instead create models or simulation that observe snapshots of these systems at different points in time, so that they can begin to understand and theorize how they work. And one last note, astronomy and astrology are two very different subjects. So if you're here to learn more about your horoscope sign, I'm sorry to say you might not be in the right place. But believe it or not, there are very interesting links between astronomy and astrology that we'll begin to go into on the next slide. Next, we're going to talk about the history of astronomy. In early ancient history, astronomy and astrology were actually very closely intertwined. Many ancient cultures associated objects in space with gods, spirits, and other religious phenomena, and many areas also actually had priests that specialized in astrology. The concept of tracking how celestial objects move was the foundation of many ancient calendars. And a fun fact, the modern calendar that we use today derives from an ancient calendar that was based on the phases of the moon. In medieval times, astronomy began to expand into a more scientific discipline. A Persian astronomer named Azophi was known for carrying out detailed observations of the stars, where he noted their location, their magnitude, their brightness, and many other scientific details. This information was slowly disseminated across the globe and is the foundation for much of what we know about the stars today. Furthermore, practical astronomical techniques concerning timekeeping and the astrolabe became popular in this era. The astrolabe is shown on the image to the right, and it's basically an ancient astronomical calculator. It can help determine altitude, it can help identify stars and planets, and it can help survey the night sky. So, through developments like this, astronomy became more and more data-driven in the medieval era. In the 16th century begins the Copernican Revolution. Before Copernicus, the dominant belief was that the Earth was at the center of our universe, and all the other planets and stars, including our Sun, orbit around it. In 1543, Nicholas Copernicus proposes the heliocentric system, in which the Sun is at the center of our solar system and the other planets, including our Earth, orbit around it instead. This was a very controversial claim at the time because it goes against the beliefs of the Church. But Newton, Galileo, Kepler, and many of his other contemporaries helped expand on this theory and helped complete their understanding of the solar system, which is the foundation of the model that we use even today. And that takes us to astronomy today. Over the past few decades, there has been a large and rapid increase in scientific and technological innovation as it relates to astronomy. With the help of these scientific discoveries and with the help of photography, further objects in the galaxy have been discovered, which were previously too faint to be seen by primitive technology. Furthermore, the discovery of X-rays, gamma rays, and other forms of light that were invisible to the naked eye has formed entirely new fields and disciplines within astronomy. Next, we're going to talk about famous astronomers throughout history. The first person we're going to talk about is Galileo Galilei, who is an Italian astronomer, physicist, and engineer. He is known today as the father of modern science and the scientific method, and he is best known for championing heliocentrism against the Catholic Church. He is among one of the first people to use a telescope to observe the night sky, where he noticed things about the planets and their movements that don't align with the theory that the Earth is at the center of the universe. He presented his scientific data to support heliocentrism, and since this opinion was so controversial at the time, he actually spent the later part of his life under house arrest. Next, we're going to talk about Johannes Kepler, a German astronomer, mathematician, and astrologer. He is best known for his laws of planetary motion, where he mathematically defines how planets move in orbit. He also invented a new form of the refracting telescope, called the Keplerian telescope. His legacy is celebrated even today. In 2009, NASA sent up the Kepler Space Telescope, which was used to identify nearby Earth-like planets, and it was actually in orbit until 2018. Lastly, we're going to talk about Stephen Hawking, a very well-known physicist and cosmologist. He made many influential contributions to the field of astronomy, one of which includes proposing that black holes emit radiation, which is now known as Hawking radiation. He also wrote A Brief History of Time, which is a very interesting read on the space-time continuum. He was also diagnosed with ALS, or Lou Gehrig's disease, and communicated through a speech-generating device for the later part of his life. If you're like me, you might be a little bit confused on how we actually study the stars. They're so distant, far away, and hard to understand. How do we actually get data from them? We're going to watch this quick video that boils that process down.
The city sky is frankly rather boring. If you look up at the patches of murk between buildings, you might be able to pick out the Big Dipper, or perhaps Orion's Belt. But hold on. Look at that murky patch again, and hold out your thumb. How many stars do you think are behind it? 10? 20? Guess again. If you looked at that thumbnail-sized patch of sky with the Hubble Space Telescope, instead of points of light, you'd see smudges. These aren't stars. They're galaxies, just like our Milky Way, cities of billions of stars, and more than 1,000 of them are hidden behind your thumb. The universe is bigger than you can see from the city, and even bigger than the starry sky you can see from the countryside. This is the universe as astrophysicists see it, with more stars than all the grains of sand on Earth. By staring up at the stars at night, you've taken part in the oldest science in human history. The study of the heavens is older than navigation, agriculture, perhaps even language itself. Yet unlike other sciences, astronomy is purely observational. We cannot control the parameters of our experiments from lab benches. Our best technology can send man to the moon and probes to the edge of the solar system. But these distances are vanishingly small compared to the yawning gulfs between stars. So how can we know so much about other galaxies, what they're made of, how many there are, or that they're even there at all? Well, we can start with the first thing we see when we look up at night, the stars. What we are trying to learn is their properties. What are they made of? How hot are they? How massive? How old? How far are they from Earth? And believe it or not, we can learn all of these things simply from the light shining in the sky. We can decipher one kind of stellar message by turning starlight into rainbows. When you look at a rainbow on Earth, you're really looking at light from our sun being scattered through water droplets in the atmosphere into all the different wavelengths that make it up. And when we study the light from other stars, we can create rainbows on demand using not water droplets, but other specific instruments that disperse light. When we look at the scattered light from our sun, we see something strange: dark lines in our rainbow. These lines are the characteristic fingerprints of atoms. Each type of atom in the solar atmosphere soaks up light at specific wavelengths, and the amount of absorption depends on how many of these atoms there are. So by observing how much light is missing at these characteristic wavelengths, we can tell not only what elements are in the sun's atmosphere, but even their concentrations. And the same idea can be applied to study other stars. Make a spectral rainbow, see what's missing, and figure out which elements are present. Bingo! Now you know what stars are made of. But we aren't restricted to just the wavelengths that our eyes perceive. Consider radio waves. Yes, they can bring the Billboard Top 100 to your car, but they can also travel almost unimpeded through space. Because they've come so far, radio waves can tell us the very early history of the universe, from just a few thousand years after the Big Bang. We can also study the infrared light emitted by colder objects like the gas and dust clouds in space, and the ultraviolet light from the hot stars recently born from those clouds. Studying different wavelengths not only gives us a more complete picture of any single object, but also different views of the universe. For this reason, astrophysicists use several different kinds of telescopes, covering the spectrum from the infrared to the ultraviolet to the X-ray, from giant radio dishes to giant silver mirrors to space satellites detecting light that would be otherwise blocked by the Earth's atmosphere. Astrophysicists don't just see the billions of stars among the billions of galaxies in the universe. They hear, feel, and sense them through many channels, each revealing a different story. But it all begins with light, the kind we can see and the kind we can't. Want to know the secrets of the universe? Just follow the light.
What does a day in the life of an astronomer actually look like? We're going to explore this by reading an interview done with Rosanna Tilbrook, who's a PhD student in astronomy at the University of Leicester. She says, "Our daily routine is pretty much your average 9-to-5. That is, until we get to go to a telescope. Then, my day starts around 1 p.m., when a hot breakfast is served. The cereal is on hand 24/7 if I sleep in later. The drive up the mountain is short but beautiful as the sun sets over the South African Karoo. Once I get to the telescope, I'll head to my office for the night, which is a small room to the side of the main part of the dome. Once it's dark enough, it's time to take a look at my targets. I'll move the telescope to point at the right part of the sky and find my star using a finding chart. Sometimes, if I'm feeling brave, I'll step out of the comfort of the telescope dome and into the inky outside world to look at the stars myself. If the night goes smoothly, I'll be taking data until just before sunrise." If you're interested in astronomy, what do you do for college? The first requirement is a bachelor's degree in astronomy, which is often completed at a four-year institution. Here you take classes in subjects like mathematics, the physical sciences, computer programming, and many more to learn the scientific skills you need to become an astronomer. For most jobs, you will pursue further education through a master's degree or a PhD program. As a lot of jobs in astronomy are in academia, these higher degrees are needed to conduct research. There are many schools across Texas that offer both astronomy bachelor's degree and astronomy doctorate and master's programs, which include Rice University, UT Austin, Baylor University, Texas Christian University, Texas Tech University, and Texas A&M University. There are a variety of different career opportunities within astronomy. As I previously mentioned, academia is one of the biggest sectors. Here you can work at a university to conduct research or to teach students. You can also conduct research in a government-sponsored laboratory or at a space agency like NASA. You can also work as an educator in planetariums, museums, observatories, and so on. The skills that you learn through an astronomy education will be helpful in many different jobs. These skills include a foundation in the physical sciences, education, computation, scientific instrumentation, science writing, and many more. Next, we're going to go over some of the different subdivisions within astronomy. First, you have planetary astronomers who study the planets in our own solar system and extrasolar planets. Then you have radio astronomers who specialize in the use of radio telescopes. Then you have solar astronomers who study the composition of the sun, sunspots, solar flares, and other solar phenomena. Then you have cosmologists, who are theoretical astronomers who study the evolution of the universe. And lastly, we have galactic astronomers, who study extremely distant objects using really sophisticated technology. Astronomy is a really unique and meaningful field. There are many benefits that come with a career as an astronomer, including really diverse career variety, working with state-of-the-art technology, experiencing a strong sense of achievement, and having many opportunities to contribute within academia. The median annual salary for astronomers was $114,590 in 2019. Furthermore, the employment of astronomers is projected to grow 7% from 2019 to 2029. So there are plenty of new jobs popping up, and this is really a growing field. Well, personally, I think the biggest benefit of astronomy is being able to understand all the cool space-related memes. I hope this presentation has given you a look into just how exciting astronomy can be, and I'm going to end by showing you my favorite TikTok on the subject.
Here's stressing over homework.
Do a quick astronomy-related activity. Believe it or not, you don't need to be at NASA to begin your journey as an astronomer. Let's see what you can learn about the stars from the comfort of your own home. You only need an internet connection and the night sky. Before you start, make sure you wait until it gets dark outside and you think you can get a clear view of the stars. Then you're going to go to Google Maps to find your current latitude and longitude coordinates. You're going to enter your coordinates in the following website linked below and take a look at the expected star pattern that you're supposed to see in the night sky. Compare the stars you see in real life to the constellations and the stars shown on the website. Does it match? Can you see the constellations? And if you're not able to see the stars tonight, let's think about why. Is it too cloudy? Can you try again another day? Or is there too much light pollution where you live for you to see anything? Thank you guys so much for listening. To gain credit for watching this class, take this short 3-minute survey, which is linked in the video description. I'll see you guys next time.